Good evening. Thanks for joining us for this evening's program, Pennsylvania in the 1918 Influenza Pandemic. I'm Andrea Lowry, the Executive Director for Pennsylvania Historical and Museum Commission. We're the Commonwealth's history agency and comprise the State Museum, the State Archives, the State Historic Preservation Office, and a number of historic sites and museums around the Commonwealth. Our goal is to share Pennsylvania's history in ways that are relevant and meaningful today and provide context for the present. So we're so glad you could join us. This is the first of a series of programs we'll be having and hope that you find it interesting. And we look forward to welcome you to future programs. And with that, I'd like to turn it over to our state archivist, David Carmichael.
Thank you, Andrea. At the PHMC, we believe very strongly that every Pennsylvanian should see history as relevant to their lives. So when we go out and we are collecting documents for the state archives, or we're collecting artifacts for historic sites or museums, we are not collecting these as historical curiosities, but as tools that we can use to make relevant decisions and relevant thoughts to our current lives. And tonight's topic and talk is really a good picture of that. Tyler Stump is going to be talking to us about the 1918 influenza pandemic. We keep hearing that the COVID-19 pandemic is unprecedented. And in many ways, of course, it is. But in one real sense, it is not unprecedented. We have had many pandemics over the years, and we can learn lessons from what happened in the past. Tyler actually started this as a talk for 500 employees of the Department of Health who wanted to learn some historical context behind what we are facing today. And it was a good use of historical records that are still relevant 100 years later to our lives today. Tyler has been an archivist at State Archives since 2016, and as part of his work, he looks for historical records and helps agencies that deal with medical issues, medical treatments, and mental health, and all kinds of health issues. So he is very well qualified to talk on this topic. So without further ado, I give you Tyler Stump.
Hi there. It's me, Tyler Stump, from the Pennsylvania State Archives. I'm really excited to be here with you all virtually. Thanks for taking the time to come and join us in this discussion of the 1918 influenza pandemic in Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania has such a rich and complicated history, and every day that I'm in the state archives, I really do learn something new about Pennsylvania's past that helps me understand part of the present in a new way. It's one of my favorite things about being an archivist. History is just so important because it helps inform our present. I hope that as we learn today about the influenza pandemic, about how Pennsylvanians coped with it back then, you'll learn something that isn't just interesting, but also helps you think about the coronavirus pandemic and the rest of our lives here in Pennsylvania today in the 21st century. Alrighty, without further ado, let's just jump right into it. Today we're going to look at the great influenza pandemic of 1918 and how it impacted the lives of Pennsylvanians. Up until relatively recently, many called this a forgotten pandemic, and the 1918 influenza really hasn't gotten a whole lot of attention from the history books, especially compared to other events that were going on around the same time period. But we're talking about an influenza pandemic that gripped Pennsylvania in 1918, and many of you have probably heard of this from its name, Spanish flu. That was probably one of the most frequently used names for this pandemic. It was also called other names like the Spanish Lady, the Devil's Grip, the three-day fever, and sometimes just flu-y. But no matter what you called it, it was a pandemic of influenza. So let's go back in time 102 years in Pennsylvania. And in 1918, Pottsville resident John O'Hara was just 13 years old. The son of a country doctor, he would never forget one fall morning when his father came home after a long stretch of work. And he later wrote, "My father came home at 4 o'clock one morning in the fall of 1918 and plumped down on a couch in the living room. He did not get awake until he heard the noise of us getting breakfast and getting ready to go to school, which had not yet closed down. When he got awake, he went out front and shut the engine off of his car, which had been running while he slept, and then he went to bed and stayed, sleeping for nearly 2 days. Up to that morning, he had been going for nearly 3 days with no more than 2 hours sleep at a stretch. In 1918, the entire world suffered through this harrowing influenza pandemic. Millions died across the globe, and Pennsylvania was right in the middle of it all. Though the worst of the pandemic only lasted about 2 months, it was enough to impact Pennsylvanians in every corner of the state. In that short time, about 60,000 Pennsylvanians died, and at some points more than 1,500 every single day. John O'Hare remembered the pandemic's impact on his community. He also wrote, "The mines closed down almost with the first whiff of influenza. Men who had for years been drilling rock and had chronic miner's asthma never had a chance against the mysterious new disease. And even younger men were keeling over. So the coal companies had to shut down the mines, leaving only maintenance men, such as pump men, in charge. Then the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania closed down the schools and churches and forbade all congregating. If you wanted an ice cream soda, you had to have it put in a cardboard container. You couldn't have it at the fountain in a glass. The pandemic was felt immediately." And John's experiences might sound a little bit out of this world to some of us, though I suspect that there are a lot of us who have had similar experiences ourselves currently in 2020 with the coronavirus pandemic. And think about that for a moment. How does John's experience compare with your own? Deadly disease was no stranger in Pennsylvania in 1918. Epidemics like smallpox, cholera, typhoid, and yellow fever, and many others, popped up every couple of years in Pennsylvania, and they had since the days of William Penn up through the early 20th century. One Harrisburg resident who grew up in the 1880s later wrote, "Everybody, as a matter of course, had measles, chickenpox, whooping cough, and mumps, and small boys used to boast after school of how many diseases they had acquired." And on the screen here, we have a quarantine notice that Pennsylvania's health authorities used in the early 1900s in a number of different typhoid epidemics. These were nothing new to Pennsylvanians. In 1918, Pennsylvania's best protection against these pandemics was the State Department of Health. It was established in 1906, so it was a relatively new state agency at this point of time, but it had a lot of experience dealing with different epidemics and outbreaks of contagious disease across the state. From its offices in the Capitol Building in Harrisburg, the Department of Health investigated outbreaks of disease and regulated sanitary conditions across Pennsylvania. And the department's commissioner, Dr. Benjamin Franklin Royer, was also pretty new to his job too. Royer was a Franklin County native and an alumni of Shippensburg University and Jefferson Medical College in Philadelphia. And he spent most of his early career working at the Philadelphia Municipal Hospital for Contagious Diseases, where he learned how to quarantine and treat outbreaks of disease, especially diphtheria. Royer started working for the State Department of Health in 1908 and eventually became the department's what they called the chief enforcer in their Infectious Disease Bureau. So he was responsible for investigating outbreaks of disease, overseeing quarantines, and implementing preventative measures to avoid future outbreaks. And if you look through letters that Royer had written that we have in the Pennsylvania State Archives, you really get the sense that he was a stern physician and administrator. And he really strikes me as somebody who's disinterested in politics and really just concerned with public health and getting that job done. And this was fairly uncommon for high-ranking Pennsylvanian government officials in the early 1900s, who often were very well connected politically. Now, in 1918, there were a lot of factors that made Pennsylvania vulnerable to infectious diseases like influenza. Influenza is a respiratory illness, so that means it's spread when infected people talk or cough or sneeze or spit or do anything else to spread droplets into the air that others would inhale or touch or get into their own bodies. When you get influenza, it immediately attacks your lungs and air passages, and so it makes you feel achy all over, and soon after that, it'll cause you to cough up blood and bleed from your nose and ears. If you have a fatal case, your lungs will fill up with fluid until you can no longer breathe, and oftentimes you'd also contract a fatal case of pneumonia. So between the two of those, it's a very dangerous disease. Many Pennsylvanians were susceptible to respiratory infections like influenza in the early 20th century because pollution in the state weakened their respiratory systems, and this was especially true in communities that lived near coal and steel industries, which was pretty much everywhere in the state at this time. and also people who live very close together in urban areas, which was a lot of people, especially in places like Philadelphia and Pittsburgh. But also, Pennsylvania was in the middle of a little thing called World War I, which I'm sure you've heard of. Pennsylvania was a transportation hub for military personnel, supplies, workers, and many other people traveling both from the Midwest to the East Coast and people traveling up and down the East Coast, especially through Philadelphia, but also through other parts of the state. And this would make it very easy for a pandemic like influenza, once it reached the state, to spread very quickly. Take Pittsburgh, for example, where tens of thousands of migrants moved during the war and lived in crowded tenement homes. In fact, the Department of Health spent most of its time in 1917 and early 1918 fighting outbreaks of smallpox that cropped up among Black war workers in Pittsburgh who had recently moved there from the southern states. At the same time, World War I also created a huge shortage of trained medical workers in Pennsylvania. About 40% of all Pennsylvania doctors and nurses were serving overseas in 1918, and many medical supplies that typically would have been in doctors' offices and hospitals were being sent to soldiers in Europe or to military bases around the state as well. Throughout World War I, Pennsylvanians gathered together often to raise funds to support the war effort, largely through the federal government's Liberty Loan Program. In 1917 and 1918, Pennsylvanians bought millions and millions of dollars worth of these war bonds. If you were living in Pennsylvania in 1918, you probably would have seen ads and posters and many other encouragements asking you to buy bonds everywhere you went. They could be bought at any bank in the state. And to support bond sales, many cities in Pennsylvania held Liberty Loan Parades, which were huge events where troops would march through the streets and celebrities and politicians would give patriotic speeches, and people were encouraged to buy Liberty Loans or bonds right there on the spot. Philadelphia held several Liberty Loan parades in 1917 and 1918, and these are just a few photos from those earlier parades. In September of 1918, Philadelphia's officials planned another Liberty Loan parade, and their goal was to raise $250 million for the war effort. But just think about that for a second. Huge crowds, all very close, crowded together, in a parade attended by military troops who had just come from locations all across the state and the world, in fact. And we now know that influenza was slowly starting to spread around Philadelphia that month. It was likely brought there by a ship carrying sailors from Boston, which was the first American city to record a major outbreak of influenza that year. We now suspect that, or historians think, that the flu's origins were probably from an army base in Kansas in the beginning of 1918, where military personnel leaving the base spread it all across the country and the world. I have here on the screen what we think is the first recorded influenza death in Philadelphia, who was a sailor named James Keegan, who died on September 19th, just 9 days before the parade was scheduled. And the first civilian death in Philadelphia was recorded just a week later on the 17th. But officials thought that these cases were isolated and decided to go on with the parade, despite the warnings of some officials and physicians in the city. And you can see here on this death certificate on the right side that pneumonia is listed as the contributory cause of death, like we've talked about a little bit earlier. And a lot of death certificates from 1918 will actually list pneumonia as the main cause of death instead, so sometimes it's hard, if we're looking at these, to determine exactly how many people had the flu, even though the flu and the pneumonia were very closely related. On September 28th, 1918, 200,000 Philadelphians crowded the city streets to watch the parade. We can't definitively say that the parade was the main catalyst for spreading the flu around the city, but in 72 hours, every hospital bed in Philadelphia's 32 hospitals were full, and by the end of the week, over 4,000 residents from the city were dead. And there were likely many in the crowd who were already carrying influenza, and they passed that to people nearby them, who then brought it back to their own neighborhoods with them. And that's why we often call this Liberty Loan Parade the deadliest parade in history. Philadelphia was completely overwhelmed and couldn't keep enough hospital beds or medical services open to victims. The Frederick Douglass Memorial Hospital, which we can see here on the screen, was just one of many hospitals that was filled to capacity within days and even took over the school next door to them to try and open up extra hospital beds to treat as many as they could. Hospitals and clinics like this one at Temple University were often staffed by medical students and Army trainees. There just weren't enough doctors or nurses to help run them all. And in the coming weeks, a quarter of Philadelphia's population contracted influenza, and by the end of the year, about 16,000 people perished. And the actual numbers were likely even higher than that. Historians today believe that deaths in Philadelphia's Black community were seriously underreported and were likely much higher. Underreporting deaths in Black Pennsylvania neighborhoods caused many to believe that influenza was a white person's problem, and Black papers from the day didn't really cover influenza to the same degree that other papers did, and so some believed incorrectly that Black people weren't as vulnerable to the illness as others. And the Philadelphia Tribune, which was one of the prominent Black papers of Philadelphia, actually wrote, "There seems to be more influenza and deaths among white people than the colored people in the city." So that was also a major problem. But it wasn't just Philadelphia. By early October, the flu had spread to all 67 Pennsylvania counties. It was present in every single community. On average, 2.5% of Pennsylvanians who came down with the influenza died. But many of Pennsylvania's small rural communities were often hit much harder. In the small Jefferson County town of Wishaw, which was just 10 miles north of Punxsutawney, 3/4 of the residents came down with the flu in the course of 1 week, and over a quarter of their population died by the end of October. One of the things about this pandemic that caught doctors off guard was just how many young and healthy people did not survive when they got influenza. And some historians think today that this was because the strain of influenza in 1918 was genetically different from earlier strains, so even healthy people didn't have enough immunity to protect themselves. And this death certificate on the screen is from a boy named John Pasidi, who was just 1 year old, and he and his entire family died within the course of that 1 week. They were some of those people from the town who died. And John actually died in an emergency hospital that the Department of Health was running. You can see that at the bottom right corner where it says Wishaw Emergency Hospital. He and his family were Italian immigrants who came there to work in the mines and hadn't been there very long when influenza came into the town. At the Corn Planter Tract, which was an American Indian reservation in Warren County, mostly inhabited by Seneca, who were in Pennsylvania and also New York State, the tract was on both parts of the state line, many died from influenza in October. And Jesse Corn Planter, one of the members of this community, was serving overseas in the military, and when he returned home in 1919, he found his entire extended family had died from the flu, except for one sister and two orphan nieces. And it's ironic that it was safer for Jesse to be out at war in Europe than it was to be at home in his own community. Prisons and mental institutions where Pennsylvanians lived in very close and often unsanitary conditions were also easy victims of the flu. This death register from Farview State Hospital, which was a mental facility in Wayne County, was hit particularly hard. In November, 360 of its 600 patients had contracted influenza, and 63 died. Farview's mortality rate was actually 17.5%. So just think of that in comparison from the average of 2.5% that we talked about earlier. And if you look at this document we have on the screen, that middle column lists the cause of death for all of these people. Everyone on this list had died of influenza, and most of them just between November 8th and November 23rd. And many of them were buried on the property right there where they perished. At Farview, nearly every physician and many attendants also died from influenza, and the state police actually had to be called in to help out at the sick ward. And one trooper later reported that practically the entire working force of the institution was disabled by the plague, and the bulk of every responsibility borne by the state police detail. Since there wasn't a strong federal health service in 1918, remember, this was before there was a CDC or anything like that, it was up to states to respond to the pandemic in their own way, and many states passed this responsibility down to individual communities. Unlike most states, Pennsylvania enacted a coordinated statewide response plan. The legislation that created the Department of Health actually gave it broad powers to respond to pandemics, and the law actually said that the department could use, quote, unilateral action, including quarantines, if it deemed them necessary. The Commissioner of Health didn't need the permission or the consent of the governor or the General Assembly or anybody else to roll out its response. They could call the shots on their own. And this was fortunate because Pennsylvania's governor, Martin Brumbaugh, had actually gotten married just before the pandemic broke and was spending most of the fall honeymooning out of the state. And the state legislature was not in session and would not return until 1919. So Commissioner Royer, who we met earlier, quickly implemented what he called a two-pronged plan to help preserve lives in a public health-based response and to keep war production in Pennsylvania going as much as possible. So instead of a full-blown quarantine, Pennsylvania had more of what we would call a crowd ban. Places of entertainment, especially saloons and theaters, were closed nationwide by the department, statewide. The department encouraged local officials to close places of worship in schools, although it did not require them. The department still allowed most businesses, especially those that were war-related, to operate. It also required all cases of influenza to be reported to the department so that they could track the spread of the disease and where it was the worst at all times. And the department initiated a public relations campaign, or a public information campaign, which was unlike some other states that told the public there was either little to fear or didn't really comment on the pandemic at all. And so compared to some other states, Pennsylvania's response is actually fairly unique in all of these regards. Part of the government's information campaign was issuing posters like these, and there are also lots of bulletins and articles that the department published in Pennsylvania newspapers with headlines like how to avoid the flu and what to do before the doctor comes. And so they had information not just on how to prevent getting sick in the first place, but then what to do if you or anyone in your family was sick and you didn't have access to medical attention immediately. So think about these messages that we have here on the screen and how they compare to signs or other notices or information that you've seen in your own neighborhood since the COVID pandemic started in 2020. Pennsylvania's Department of Health worked closely with the Pennsylvania Council of National Defense, which was another state organization in charge of directing the state's involvement in World War I. The council helped distribute medical supplies, helped transport physicians and nurses to affected areas around the state, and many other things. And this was especially important in Pennsylvania, where there were many rural areas where travel was slow and there was often only a handful of physicians practicing in the entire county. And sometimes that we have documents in the archives where local officials were complaining that they had to recruit Boy Scouts to be stretcher bearers and assistants in hospitals because there was no one else to help. So being able to move physicians and other medical staff around the state was critically important. This photograph on the screen is from one Department of Health emergency hospital that the Council on National Defense helped raise in Gettysburg. And many of these hospitals would look like this, even with horse-drawn ambulances. Pennsylvania established and ran around 300 emergency hospitals all across the state, including this one that was built on the present York County Fairgrounds in York County. Emergency hospitals were built or converted from existing buildings such as churches, schools, municipal buildings and courthouses, private country clubs, theaters, lodge rooms, private homes, garages, barracks, and sometimes were even just constructed in open fields out of tents and other things. Anywhere there was space, they would put up an emergency hospital if it was a place that people could get to easily. One influenza survivor later described his stay in an emergency hospital in Pottsville, and he wrote, "Several times a day, the nurse would come with camphorated oil and give you a rub, which was just perfect bliss, for there was an ache in every part of your body, and how good did this make you feel?" Another phase of the treatment was not so pleasant, when the nurse appeared with iodine and a medicine dropper, and dropped it in your nostrils. Have you ever tasted iodine? If you haven't, you will have no conception of that terrible sensation I had when it trickled down my throat. The Pennsylvania Department of Health's measures were fairly well received across the state, but there was some opposition, especially to the crowd ban that we talked about earlier. Lancaster loudly opposed the close orders from the state, and city leaders there actually pointed to a clause in their city charter that they said let them supersede state law if they needed to, and so they reopened saloons and theaters against state orders. And in response to that, Commissioner Royer actually had state police block all roads into Lancaster and ordered trains to detour around the city. And in the face of that pressure, Lancaster soon after closed everything up again. Pittsburgh delayed enforcing the crowd ban and waited nearly a month to close schools and places of worship or saloons and theaters in the city. Pittsburgh's mayor feuded with Commissioner Royer in the press, and the two fought each other for weeks, writing newspaper articles that would attack each other for these closures, but the ban remained in place. And one thing that I find really interesting about this is that the influenza pandemic and the closures after that really exposed just how important entertainment was in the lives of Pennsylvanians. And it wasn't just a luxury, but it was really an important part of many people's emotional and psychological well-being. And I just find this really interesting because movie theaters and some of these other types of places like amusement parks just hadn't been around that long, and they were relatively new for Pennsylvanians, but they were really an important part of their lives. And so I just think this is a good opportunity for us to think today about some of the things that we've missed because of the pandemic. And were there any things that have surprised us so far that we missed more than we thought we might? I'm sure there are some things for you. The closures remained in Pennsylvania through state orders for about 4 weeks, and they ended in the beginning of November. The influenza pandemic was felt every day in many different ways, and it was felt especially hard for quarantining families who struggled to keep food on their tables and keep their homes in order, especially when they had children who were sick. John O'Hara, who we heard from earlier, remembered one family of Hungarian immigrants who were all sick with the flu in a Carbon County mining town. And he wrote, "In one of the front rooms was an old-fashioned bed. The windows were curtained, but when our eyes became accustomed to the darkness, we could see four children lying on the bed. The youngest and the oldest were lying together. The oldest, a girl about 5 years old, was only half covered by the torn quilt that covered the others. The baby coughed as we came in. The other two were sound asleep. The half-covered little girl got awake, opened her eyes, and looked at the ceiling. She had a half-sneering look about her nose and mouth, and her eyes were expressionless. Dr. Myers leaned over her, and so did her mother, speaking to the girl. But the girl apparently made no sense, even in the Hungarian language. She sounded as though she were trying to clear her throat of phlegm." The pandemic put a tremendous strain on Pennsylvania's healthcare workers, and doctors like John O'Hara's father worked literally to the point of physical exhaustion. In many cases, local health officials had to recruit volunteers from the Red Cross, nuns, Boy Scouts, any other locals that would be able to help. And we have many reports in the archives stating that these volunteers worked 15 hours a day, driving ambulances, delivering medical supplies to hospitals, burying the dead, anything that was needed for days and days on end without rest. Businesses in Pennsylvania also struggled during the pandemic, and with sick workers and a dramatic decrease in customers coming to their stores, many businesses reported sharp drops in profit and some went out of business too. The Bell Telephone Company of Pennsylvania had so many sick telephone operators that they actually put out ads saying, "Please do not call anyone unless it's official war business or in case you're sick with the flu," because they just didn't have enough people to patch all of those calls through. Shortages on coffins and space in morgue and grave diggers, and also bans on public funerals from the Department of Health, meant that many victims in Pennsylvania were buried in unmarked mass graves. And just a few years ago, actually in 2015, the State Department of Transportation uncovered an unmarked mass grave in Schuylkill County as they were widening parts of Route 61. And this photograph here shows part of that grave and some of the skeletons that they uncovered during that excavation. And there are likely many other unmarked graves from the influenza pandemic scattered across the state. By late November and early December, the influenza pandemic finally waned in Pennsylvania. Over time, people who contracted the virus developed an immunity to this particular strain of influenza. And although there were secondary and tertiary waves after 1918, they were far less severe, so things were able to relatively return to normal. But by the end of 1918, about 60,000 Pennsylvanians perished in the influenza pandemic. And this Department of Health graph shows the death rate in Pennsylvania across the first quarter of the 20th century. And you can see that big spike in the middle is just from the influenza pandemic. It was that big of a deal. Interesting, though, or something that I find very interesting, is that many Pennsylvanians later thought that the pandemic was basically forgotten soon afterwards. And writing just 5 years later, a newspaper article from Wishaw, which was that Jefferson County town that lost a quarter of its residents, one article wrote, at the time we marveled that a scourge so great had received so little attention in history. Not from that time until now have we ever seen more than a casual reference to the matter. And that was just 5 years afterwards. The author Catherine Ann Porter, who lived in Doylestown for a while and lived through the pandemic herself, believed that World War I overshadowed the flu pandemic. But for her and many others who met influenza up close and personal, they would never forget it. And decades later, Catherine Ann Porter wrote, "I think of my personal history as before the plague and since the plague," and I'm sure many would agree with her. So looking back, Pennsylvania has what I would say is a mixed legacy with its experience with the 1918 pandemic. It was able to mobilize at a state level and protect many lives, but many local communities really struggled when the flu came to town, especially those that were isolated or didn't have quick access to medical care. If you'd like to learn more about the 1918 influenza pandemic in Pennsylvania, the Pennsylvania Archives is a great place to start. We have lots of documents related to the pandemic, including letters from Department of Health and other state officials, scrapbooks, proclamations from the governor, including things like one proclamation ordering nurses in the state to leave private practice and go help the general public in emergency hospitals. We have bulletins and articles written by the Department of Health. We have the minutes of meetings from different state department officials who were meeting and talking about the progress and response to the pandemic. And we also have the largest collection of records we have related to this is the death certificates for all Pennsylvanians who perished in the pandemic. And those are all actually available online through ancestry.com. And these are all the records that I used to research this publication or this presentation. I also used a few published memoirs and oral histories from Pennsylvanians too. And each document really just, each one tells an important part of this bigger story. So together they really complete this great bigger picture. But we also know that there's a lot of this story that we just don't know. Many records either weren't saved or were lost over the decades, and it's been 100 years. And in some cases, we know that Pennsylvanians just weren't recording their experiences during the influenza pandemic. In November of 1918, the director of a Clearfield County Emergency Influenza Hospital wrote that they were just too busy helping flu victims to stop and document their work. So he wrote, "It is difficult to furnish detailed statistics at a time when everyone gave of their time, ability, and substances called for. Few records were kept." And I think this is a really important lesson for us today when we think about preserving our own experiences living through the coronavirus pandemic. All of us have experienced the pandemic this year in our own way, and we all have a chance now to preserve our own stories and memories for the future. Anything can be a historical record or an artifact, as long as it tells your story or your community's story. And take a second just to think about that. What would you save if you wanted to preserve your experience for the future? A few examples are the letters and emails that you've been writing, pictures from your neighborhood or your home during quarantine, social media posts that you've written or that you've been reading while you're at home, a lot of objects that you've used, I think especially masks, if you've made any or been using them, those are an important thing to save for the future as well. There are many things that you can have to tell your story. If you aren't sure what you should save, ask yourself a few questions. What has my life been like during the pandemic? What's changed my daily routine? One question I like to ask myself is, in 50 years from now, if I wanted to tell somebody about my experience in 2020, what types of records or documents or other things would I want to illustrate my story? These are the types of things that you'd want to hold on to and save and keep in a safe place. If you think you don't have any records or other things you want to save right now, you can write your experiences down or interview somebody else who has an interesting story, or take pictures of places that you've been or that have been important in your life during the COVID pandemic. It doesn't have to be now, but it's just something you can do when you have time and when it's safe. Keep these things stored in a safe place where they won't get moved or thrown out by accident in the future. And make sure you label them so that other people know they're important too. And if you need help or you have more questions, you can always get in touch with your local historical society. Pennsylvania has many across the state, and they have many experts and volunteers who would love to help you preserve your story. And if you'd like to learn even more about the 1918 influenza pandemic in Pennsylvania, or how to preserve your own story from the pandemic today, you can contact the Pennsylvania State Archives. Alrighty, so what'd you think? I hope you learned something new about the 1918 pandemic. And I hope that you'll also think about preserving your own stories and memories from the pandemic we're living through today for the future. Pennsylvania State Archives is still closed because of the pandemic today, but when we open back up again in the future, I hope that you'll come and visit us so you can learn from Pennsylvania's past up close and personal. And in the meantime, be on the lookout for more great presentations from my colleagues here at the Pennsylvania Historical and Museum Commission. We're excited to see you in the future.